Hi, welcome back. In the previous lecture, that is lecture number 3, we discussed the history of insect classification as well as the present status. The classification given by Carolus Linnaeus, followed by Fabricius, Breyer, and then Hume's classification given by Richards and Davies were discussed. In fact, all those classifications were considered as artificial because only one or few morphological characters were used in classifying these insects. But followed by the Ennick's Phylogenetic Systematics publication, who is considered as father of cladistics, Christensen came out with a phylogenetically accepted classification, which is widely adopted now. In fact, in this lecture, I'll be discussing old classification, that is Hume's classification given by Richards and Davies, and new classification given by Christensen, so that students can have a quick look into both the old classification as well as the new classification. And also they can understand why the classification actually keeps on changing over time. In fact, I'll try to give an hypothetical example in order to show why classification changes over time. And also I'll be covering some of the terminologies so that you will better understand the importance of classification as well as the new classification system, which is widely adopted and given by Christensen. So in fact, previously widely accepted classification was Hume's classification given by Richards and Davies. And in this, all these insects were placed under the class Insecta, which consisted two subclasses. Subclass Pterygota, which consists of all the wingless insects, and Pterygota, which consists all the winged insects. So Pterygota consisted of Thysanura, Columbola, Protura, and Diplura. And Pterygota consisted two divisions, Exopterygota and Endopterygota. So in fact, terra means wings, okay, a means absence, exo means outside, endo means inside. So a pterygota means wingless insects, pterygota means winged insects. Exopterygota means wing development occurs externally, whereas endopterygota means wing development occurs internally. So exopterygota insects included Epimeraptera, Odonata, Plecoptera, Grilloblatodea, Arthoptera, Phasmida, Dermoptera, Embioptera, Dictyoptera, Isoptera, Zooroptera, Socoptera, Mallophaga, Siphonculata, Hemiptera, and Thysanoptera. So this group is considered as, Arthopterid orders, excluding the Epimeraptera and Odonata, which are considered as Paleopteran orders, wherein they do not have the wing flexion mechanism. Okay, so starting from 16 to 20, these orders are considered as Hemipteroid orders, which have got piercing and sucking type of mouthparts. Whereas endopterygotan orders includes Neuroptera, Mecoptera, Lepidoptera, Trichoptera, Diptera, Siphonoptera, Hymenoptera, Coleoptera, and Strepsiptera. So these insects which undergo complete metamorphosis, there will be 4 stages. So this is the classification which was widely adopted and used for till recent time. But, Ennick's work followed by Christensen classification made us to adapt to new classification. So, in many colleges, the Sims classification is being taught till now, but there is a need of adapting to new classification which needs to be taught to students so that they'll have a better picture what was actually the changes which took place in the recent period. So as per the old classification, that is Sims classification, there were two subclasses, Pterygota and Pterygota. So what was the characters which were actually considered in order to distinguish these two subclasses? So wings, Pterygotans are primarily wingless. So they are completely wingless groups. Whereas Pterygotans, they are winged or secondarily wingless. So secondarily wingless means their ancestors had wings, but because of adaptation to particular environmental condition, they lost their wings. Say for example, head louse, bed bugs. So many other insect groups, for example, they have lost their wings now in order to adapt to particular environmental conditions. As a result of that, they do not possess wings at present, but their ancestors had wings. So those are considered as secondarily wingless. Coming to metamorphosis, they are slight or absent in case of Pterygota. Pterygota, they may be simple or complete. Pregenital abdominal appendages are present in Pterygota. They are absent in case of Pterygota. So there will not be any abdominal appendage in Pterygotan insects, winged insects. Mandibular articulations, Pterygotans are considered as monocondylic. That means the mandible, in fact, articulate with the head at single point or attached to head at single point. Whereas pterygotans, they have attachment at two points. Okay, mandibles are attached to head capsule at two points. In fact, our understanding has improved in terms of this monocondylic and dicondylic articulation in case of A. pterygota and pterygota. That also is a one important parameter. As a result of that, the classification in fact changed. I will come to that later again. Moulting. So adults in fact moults in case of A. pterygotes, whereas in case of pterygota, only immature moults. Okay, so A. pterygotes moults throughout its life. So those are the distinguishing feature of A. pterygota and pterygota. Of course, now we'll not use the word A. pterygota in hierarchical classification. So coming to two divisions of pterygota, okay. So exopterygota and endopterygota under now division subclass pterygota. So in case of metamorphosis, exopterygotans undergo simple or gradual metamorphosis, which is considered as hemimetabolous or parametabolous. Endopterygotans, complex or holometabolans. Pupal stage, absent or rarely present. So this is the one important parameter which now usually confuses, especially some of the hemipterans and thrips, lysanopterans, have a pupal stage. So even though they got pupal stage, why they are actually not placed under endopterygota? This is the common question asked. So now keep following my lectures so that you will understand. Here in this case, endopterygotans, so pupal stage is present. Wing development occurs externally. So here you can find the wing pads which are developing externally in the nymphal stage itself. Okay, so you can find those now wing pads in the nymphal stage, and the adult will have a completely developed wings. In case of endopterygota, there will be wing buds, and wing buds develop internally. So that is the difference between the endopterygota and exopterygota. So immature stages resemble adults in structure and habit. Okay, so almost they look similar except the genitalia as well as the wings. Okay, immatures. Whereas in case of endopterygota, they differ from adults in structure and habit. Okay, they look entirely different. For example, a caterpillar become a butterfly. Okay, they look, the structural organization takes place. As a result, they will have a very different structure from the larva stage. And their habitat also changes. Okay, larvae will be feeding, for example, on the plants, whereas the adults will feed the nectar or the pollen. So that's how they, in fact, they change during the growth and development. Whereas now the updated classification given by Christensen need to be followed, which needs to be adopted. Okay, so here all those insects are actually upgraded, placed under the rank superclass or epiclass called Hexapoda. So there are two unranked groups called Entognathus Hexapoda and Ectognathus Hexapoda. So Entognathus Hexapoda consists of two classes, class Elipura, class Diplura. Elipura consists of order Protura and Columbola, whereas Diplura consists of one order Diplura. So these three orders are considered as non-insect and Hexapoda, whereas all those true insects are placed under the class Insecta. They are Ectognathus Hexapoda. Okay, so then class Insecta consists of two subclasses, Archaeognatha, subclass Dicondylia. And subclass Dicondylia consists of infraclass Thysanura and infraclass Pterygota. Infraclass Pterygota consists of division Paleoptera, Epimeroptera, Odonata. They do not have wing flexion mechanism, whereas Neopterans have got wing flexion mechanism. So division Neoptera consists of subdivision Polyneoptera. Okay, all these orders are considered as orthopteroid orders with biting and chewing type of mouth parts. Whereas Paraneopteroid orders, which are also called Hemipteroid orders, which have got piercing and sucking type of mouth parts. Whereas the subdivision Oligoneoptera, they are insects with complete metamorphosis with four stages. Okay, so this is the updated classification which needs to be adopted, and we'll see what is the distinguishing features of different classes or ranks. So coming to Entognathus Hexapoda and Ectognathus Hexapoda, what are the distinguishing characters? So Entognatha means the mouth parts lie in the cavity of the head and they are not visible. Okay, so mandible or maxilla are totally withdrawn into the head. They are not externally exposed. So whereas in case of Ectognatha, mouth parts are visible external to the head. That is one character. Whereas the antennae, in case of entognatha hexapoda, which are also called non-insectan hexapoda, the intrinsic muscles are found in the flagellar segments, which are absent in case of ectognatha hexapoda or true insects. Okay, so that's why this type of antenna wherein intrinsic muscles are present in all these flagellar segments are considered as segmented antenna. If they are absent, they are considered as annulated antenna. So annulated antenna is found in case of ectognatha hexapoda. So this is the distinguishing feature of entognatha hexapoda and ectognatha hexapoda. Similarly, so there are two subclasses, subclass Archaeognatha and subclass Dicondylia. What is that? So in fact, one of the important feature which now led to change in the classification is the mandible articulation. I was telling about monocondylic articulation and dicondylic articulation. Okay, so previously all the aterygotans, okay, considered as insects with monocondylic articulation. But you can see here, Thysanura is considered as infraclass under the subclass Dicondylia. So that indicates that Thysanura have got dicondylic articulation. So that is the improvement in our understanding that led to change in the classification. Okay, so monocondylic articulation means, so there will be a round prominence, okay, through which the mandibles are attached to head capsule. There will be a single round prominence. Whereas in case of dicondylia, there will be two condyles, okay, at two points, mandibles are attached to head. Okay, so mandibles are attached to head at two points and they are articulated. So, and they are movable. So that's how, in fact, our understanding changed and classification also changed. Similarly, so you can see, although they are all aterygotans, we will not use the word aterygota at hierarchical classification. That is the one improvement now, in fact, we adopted. Okay, so that is the classification. The Christensen classification need to be adopted now. So you may ask me why classification, in fact, changes over time. I will take an hypothetical example and try to explain. Assume that there are two families called Noctuidae and Erebidae, which are actually now Lepidopteran families. In case of Noctuidae, there are two subfamilies, subfamily 1 and subfamily 2. Under subfamily 1, there are two tribes, tribe 1 and tribe 2. Under tribe 2, species 1, one species has been described so far. Similarly, in case of Erebidae, there are two subfamilies and subfamily 2 has got two tribes, tribe 1 and tribe 2. And tribe 1 has got two species. So this is an hypothetical example. For example, in the year 2015, a taxonomist came out with a new species, which he places under the tribe 2. And he places under the tribe 2 of family Noctuidae. But what happens? After a few years, so another taxonomist in the year 2020, he feels that whatever the species 2 described by the first taxonomist actually not belongs to family Noctuidae, and with the supporting evidences, he proved that, and he moves that particular species under the tribe 1 of Erebidae family. See what happened. So which was earlier considered under the family Noctuidae, now being shifted to family Erebidae. As a result of that, okay, classification in fact changed. So this may happen at any level of hierarchical classification. The tribe itself may change. Entire tribe may be shifted to Noctuidae here in this from Erebidae. Or tribe 1 of Noctuidae may be shifted to Erebidae. Okay, so this type of freedom has been given to taxonomist. As a result, the classification in fact keeps on changing. So only thing that it should be monophyletically based and they have to prove with the supporting evidences. Okay, so these are the number of described species in the world. So far 10,67,011 species have been described around the globe. Among them, 63,760 are from India. If you look at this, so I have followed the Christensen classification, which consists of 31 orders. You can see here, order Notoptera consists of Manto, Posmatodia and Globlatodia. So with the total 55 number of species around the globe, and none of them are being reported from India. Similarly, Blatodia and Isoptera have been combined. Okay, Isoptera do not have any order status now. Combinedly, 10,251 species have been described around the world with 457 species from India. Okay, so if you look at the data, 44 species have been described under the Zoroptera, which is actually lowest among the all the orders. So Zoroastra is considered as the smallest order, whereas the Coleoptera is considered as the largest order with 389,487 species. Among them, 17,455 species have been described. Okay, so if anybody is interested, now you can email and get this data. So it will also give the supported research paper so that you can have a better look of all these data. And also now we know that there are 5 million species of insects are estimated. So there is a lot of scope for young entomologists to take up taxonomical research so that they can name new species, or they can involve in classifying the insects. As a result, they can place their name next to scientific name so that their name will be ever remembered. So that is the opportunity the entomology actually gives. So at the end, I'll try to give the updated version of this Christensen classification, which needs to be adapted. So superclass or epiclass Hexapoda consists of two unranked groups, Entognathus Hexapoda and Ectognathus Hexapoda. Okay, so Entognathus Hexapoda consists of two classes, class Helicura, class Diplura. So both these classes are considered as non-insectan Hexapoda. Hence, we have a class Insecta, which are true insects, consists of two subclasses, subclass Archaeognatha, subclass Dicondylia. Okay, so subclass Dicondylia consists of infraclass Thysanura, infraclass Therigota. Infraclass Thysanura consists of single order Thysanura, which is also called Zygantoma. Whereas infraclass Therigota consists of division Paleoptera and division Neoptera. So Paleoptera means, paleo means fold, terra means wings. So that means they do not have wing flexion mechanism. Whereas division Neoptera have got insects with wing flexion or wing bending mechanism. So the Paleopteran orders includes Epimeraptera and Odonata. Whereas Neopteran, division Neoptera consists of three subdivisions, subdivision Polyneoptera, Paraneoptera and Oligoneoptera. Okay, so these are the Polyneopteran orders, Plecoptera, Blatodia, Mantodia, Notoptera, Dermoptera, Orthoptera, Plasmatodia, Embioptera and Zoroptera. So these are also called Orthopteroid orders. So with the mandibulate or biting and chewing type of mouthparts. Whereas subdivision Paraneoptera, which are considered as Orthopteroid orders. Okay, Socoptera, Theroptera, Thysanoptera and Hemiptera. So those insects with piercing and sucking type of mouthparts. Whereas subdivision Oligoneoptera consists of Megaloptera, Rapidioptera, Neuroptera, Coleoptera, Strepsiptera, Hymenoptera, Mecoptera, Siphonoptera, Diptera, Trichoptera and Lepidoptera. So these insects with complete metamorphosis, or sometimes there may be hypermetamorphic insects as well. So this is the widely accepted classification, and it needs to be followed by all of us. So from this class onwards, in fact, I'll be talking about characters of each of these orders. Okay, we'll find out the distinguishing characters of each of these orders, all the 31 orders. And at the same time, we may discuss identification character of important families of major orders. Okay, so only important, economically important families will be covered under major orders. Okay, so because, say for example, in case of Coleoptera itself, there may be hundreds of families have been described around the globe. Okay, not all will be covered. So only important families with important species under major families will be covered. Okay, so some of the species have got wide distribution and they may be economically important, they may be beneficial or harmful. Okay, so those more common name and scientific name will be studied so that it will be acts as a base for all the future courses of entomology. So keep following my lectures so that we will be studying the characters of order and families of important orders. So thank you very much. If there are any questions, you can post below or you can email me as well. Thank you very much.